Welcome everyone to another live event at the Henry Jackson Society. I'm Craig Tiedman, the Director of Policy and Research here at HJS. And today I have the honor of hosting our very distinguished guest, Ambassador John Bolton, for what should be a fascinating conversation on US foreign policy. Today's event is entitled Ambassador Bolton on US Foreign Policy, Looking Back and Looking Forward. Ambassador Bolton has served at the highest levels in the US government, and throughout his distinguished career, he's had a major impact on US foreign policy. Ambassador Bolton served in numerous administrations and senior positions at USAID, US Department of Justice, the Department of State, and most recently at the White House as the assistant to President Trump for National Security Affairs. Ambassador Bolton has written several books, including his most recent memoir about his experience serving as the US National Security Advisor in the Trump administration. The book is entitled The Room Where It Happened, a White House memoir I'm holding up here. I've read it cover to cover. I recommend you go out and buy the book if you haven't done so already. On behalf of the Henry Jackson Society, I want to thank Ambassador Bolton for joining me here today. Welcome, Mr. Ambassador.
Well, thanks very much for inviting me. Glad to be with you. Sorry it's virtual, but we'll get through this soon enough, I suppose, but glad to do it.
And hopefully in the new year, we can have you here in London personally. So we're very hopeful. So it's a real honor to have you here. I guess I should mention to the audience that the sequence of events is Ambassador Bolton and I will have a discussion for about a half an hour, and then we're going to open it up for questions from you all. And you simply have to use the Q&A function on your Zoom screen, and someone will be filtering your questions to me. Please identify yourself when you ask the question. So this event will not run the full hour up until 4 p.m. GMT. We're going to cut it short at 3:55 GMT. The ambassador has another engagement. So without further ado, we want to get right into it. So Mr. Ambassador, are you ready for some questions?
Sure, let's go. That's great. That sounds
great. Let's do this. So let's start with looking back. U.S. foreign policy under Trump. You served for almost a year and a half as the National Security Advisor. Looking back, what would you say your most important achievements were in foreign policy, you having an influence on foreign policy?
Well, I think in several respects, we made progress in continuing to break from the Obama administration's substantially misguided view of the world. And I think withdrawal from the Iran nuclear agreement of 2015 was significant. I think despite President Trump's public rhetoric, I think we did a number of things to take a very, very much tougher line on Russia. And I think on China, in part because Trump came to see the threat that the China posed to the U.S. and the West as a whole, which I think is the existential international affairs question for all of us for the 21st century. I think there was a lot of progress there, a lot more to be made and a huge subject for discussion, but nonetheless very significant. And I think being able to get the U.S. defense budget up to $750 billion a year, that will be the last figure in the administration. We now face the risk of cuts from the Biden administration. But this went a long way, not far enough, but went a long way to correcting the terrible deficiencies in our military capabilities during the Biden administration, something that is important kind of across the board. Although, again, as we've just seen reported publicly and very painfully in the past few days, not enough given this very disturbing, very significant, sophisticated Russian computer attack in cyberspace that we're still learning the full details of. So I would say it's a mixed record. And I just say, by way of explanation, it's because Trump doesn't think in policy terms. He thinks episodically, anecdotally. I've described his decisions, many of which I obviously agree with, as being like an archipelago of dots. They're just kind of out there. You can try and draw lines between them, but it's a frustrating exercise.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. And you certainly alluded to that in your book. I enjoyed reading a lot of the anecdotes. It's one of those things where you had almost a year and a half. It would have been great to have, in personal opinion, to have had you there longer. What do you think you might have achieved if you'd stayed a bit longer? And what would you have wanted to achieve in addition to those things that you just mentioned?
Yeah. Well, actually, I put it in the opposite perspective. In retrospect, I wish I'd been the first national security advisor, not the third. That's not to say that my tenure would have been any longer. But I think the administration and the transition made significant mistakes in the early days. I think the transition began with throwing out all the work that the pre-election transition led by Governor Chris Christie had done. That was a mistake. It meant they had to start all over again. And the transition in the White House in the first 6 months, almost everybody involved had no prior experience in the federal government. And by no, I mean none. A couple people, Steve Bannon had experience in the Navy as a lieutenant, which is, I salute his service, but it's not quite the same as really knowing how the government functions. So in the transition, in those first several months, there were a lot of opportunities missed because people didn't realize how the government's supposed to function. And I think, unfortunately, it also established patterns of work and expectation that affected the rest of the 4 years of the administration. This was Don McGahn, the first White House counsel for Trump and a veteran of the Bush 43 administration, used to lean over to me occasionally and say, he would whisper, "This is not the Bush administration." And that was certainly right. And I don't think process ultimately totally governs outcome, but when you don't have a coherent process, it by definition makes achieving sound outcomes harder.
Yes, and I'll just jump ahead because hypothetically, let's just say that President-elect, as we're calling him, President-elect Biden, I guess, at this point in time, although Trump still hasn't conceded, let's say you got a phone call from him tomorrow, and he said, "Hey, Ambassador Bolton, I could really use your help. How do I? I want to pick your brain on." How do I form a solid national security team that's effective based on your experience, because you've served in other administrations? What sort of advice would you give him in forming that team?
Yeah, well, he already has substantial parts of it together, but I think even from what he's announced publicly, I'm already worried there's a lot of duplication and overlap and uncertainty about who's doing what to whom. You've got John Kerry, a former Secretary of State, as the international climate change czar, and a seat on the National Security Council, sitting in an office in the State Department, coming to the sit room for meetings. Does anybody seriously think John Kerry is going to confine himself to talking about climate change? Not a chance, as far as I know. And he's known Biden longer than almost everybody else associated with it. And so I think there are, that's just one example, but it's certainly the biggest. I think the other, and so confusion at the staff level is not as bad as confusion at the presidential level, but it makes things harder. I think another problem he's got already is that so many of these people have served under him before for long periods of time. They obviously know his thinking very well. That's an advantage. But I think the Biden administration has a risk of groupthink. And look, since most of them were veterans of the Obama administration, thinking that they can simply default to the views and policies they held then, as, for example, simply rejoining the Iran nuclear deal, that I think they'll find very problematic. So just going ahead, he needs to worry about that.
Yeah, I was just about ready to ask you, too. It's what are the foreign policy initiatives that you think that he should hold over from the Trump administration? And then where are the where's the friction in some of the initiatives that may not have worked and need some adjustment in your mind?
Well, I think a lot of the problem with Trump administration policy was that while at the rhetorical level, it may have been good, we support Juan Guaido against the Maduro dictatorship in Venezuela, for example, we didn't implement effectively, and so we haven't carried the policy through to its logical conclusion. I think Biden, ironically, benefits from the shift that Trump made in the view of China, taking a much harder line in the last 6 or 8 months, largely because of the coronavirus and the widespread and quite correct popular perception that China withheld information on the coronavirus, in effect corrupted the World Health Organization, and therefore made it much harder for the rest of the world to deal with it. What that has done is we have surveys that show in the US, in Europe, and elsewhere, has contributed to a dramatically negative view of China, at least an increase in the negative view across the board. That certainly supports a harder line on a variety of Chinese policies, whether it's in the South China Sea or in cyberspace or in the economic sphere. Now, Trump may have reversed that had he gotten the second term, but Biden benefits from, at least directionally, from the way it's going now. On the other hand, again, to come back to John Kerry and the environmental issue on climate change, China is the biggest problem, I think, as they see it right now. How is President Biden going to handle a harder line on a range of China policies, which I think is required, versus Kerry saying, but we need to cooperate with them on climate change? I think this is going to be a lot harder than they think.
Yeah, and on this side of the Atlantic, it's starting in I think 2019. Yeah, we've seen the British government and even European governments starting to question the feel-good policies towards China. It may have been the start of the sort of wolf warrior diplomacy effort on behalf of the Chinese diplomats. But then you've got the COVID pandemic, and what I wanted to ask you, which is really the elephant in the room, is this pandemic has changed everything. It's almost like we could say that the world is world history is pre-COVID and post-COVID in a lot of ways. How would you assess China's overall behavior during this pandemic?
Yeah, well, they suppressed information right from the outset. I mean, the South China Morning Post some time ago identified the first known cases in China in early November of 2019. And yet China told nobody, didn't reveal the extent of it. I don't think to this day we know really what's happened in China. We keep hearing the disease is suppressed, a few harsh measures, but basically that China escaped the worst of it. I don't believe that. I think they've had more difficulty than they've let on. I think they've had more economic difficulty than they've let on. And I think they have gone out of their way to make it probably impossible today to know exactly or to do enough investigation to come to a reasonable conclusion where the disease started. I don't by the conspiracy theory necessarily in all its manifestations. But, there's a lot of research in China on bat fevers. And I'm just curious why there's so much interest in bat fevers. It's like asking for the Russians, why are they so interested in Ebola? Look, we know they've got an active biological weapons program, and they could have had an accident. I'm not saying it was deliberate or anything like that, but I'm saying it certainly is curious how this phenomenon continues. And so when China says, for example, they don't want to be involved in strategic arms talks with the U.S. and Russia because they don't have as many nuclear weapons, how about talks about their biological weapons program? I mean, this is very, very troubling, and yet they've gone out of their way to draw a curtain across it. And I'm just not sure we'll ever get enough information really to know the origin and spread of this disease in China.
Yeah, in your mind, do you think they've expressed remorse for this? Or, it doesn't seem like, it seems like China's just moving forward on their regular program and sort of aggressive moves in South China Sea and around the world. I mean, how do you think that the U.S. and even, you know, Britain and Europe should respond to this?
Yeah, well, I think it's part of the late breaking realization that we've had on a variety of fronts of the challenge that China really poses. For example, the threats from Huawei and ZTE to fifth generation telecommunication. We should be thankful for the Australians and the New Zealanders who really sensed it first. I give them enormous credit for alerting the United States and so on. And I think we're seeing a growing awareness of the threat that these particular weaponized firms pose in telecoms, but we see it in a lot of other areas too. And so I think the US, UK, the West as a whole really need to emulate the Chinese and get a long-term strategy in place. Right now, we're responding on an ad hoc fashion, which is fine. I'd rather be doing it that way than not responding at all. But Biden has an opportunity if his administration thinks strategically, and not just in terms of Asia and the Pacific, but particularly Europe as well. And I would say in the Middle East too, between Arab states and Israel. China is very energy dependent, and it's a real vulnerability for them. Something that we should be looking at exploiting.
Yes, and certainly Britain and Europe, have expressed the need to respond, and yet we have the second elephant in the room on this side, which is Brexit, and I just wondered if you could share your thoughts. How might the U.S. A Biden administration how might the U.S. play a role in helping this impasse? COVID crisis has really amplified a lot of things, and Brexit. You know, again, the Prime Minister has announced yet another sort of impasse. What's the U.S. interest in this, and what can we do?
Well, I think there's a huge U.S. interest. I was a supporter of Brexit in 2016 and before, for that matter. I think it goes to a basic question of sovereignty of a democratic system that makes its own decisions, not having them made by a distant bureaucracy and not so geographically distant, but certainly politically distant bureaucracy in Brussels. I think it was a great missed opportunity in the Trump administration for British governments not to move ahead with the basis of a bilateral trade deal with the United States. I mean, I know what the European Union treaties say, but I would have said, we're getting out anyway. We don't care. We're not going to enter a bilateral trade agreement with the U.S. until we're out, but we're certainly going to get it ready. So we missed some opportunities there. And with Biden coming in, I know there's concern in the U.K. and there's some warrant for it because Biden, again, this is the default position of the Obama administration, just thinks the European Union is a wonderful example of ceding national sovereignty to supranational institutions. And you'll remember Obama's famous comment when he came over to visit David Cameron, saying, well, if you get out, you'll be at the back of the queue in trade negotiations. Queue not being a word Americans use very often. I know where he got that from somebody in London. Biden comes with another potential problem, and that's this rhetoric, which I think is completely unfounded, but nonetheless present, about a Brexit that somehow undercuts the Good Friday Agreement concerning Northern Ireland. This has nothing to do with the technicalities of how to handle the border situation there, which I think really Boris Johnson's done a good job of coming to a practical, workable way to handle. But the fear that somehow or another the George Mitchell's legacy will come undone. Now, I think that's utterly wrong, but I do think Johnson needs to worry about that as part of establishing his relationship with Biden. What I would urge on the assumption that there's an agreement. And I, you know, like it's a coin toss as we get to the end of the year. But one way or the other, I think senior British officials ought to be talking to the Biden transition team right now about a trade deal. And I'd make whatever progress is still possible at a technical level with the U.S. Trade Representative's office in the remaining days of the Trump administration. But I would spend a lot of political capital trying to establish a good linkage between Biden and Boris Johnson. And I think the trade deal is central to that.
Yeah. Do you think that the Biden team has reached out to the Clintons? You know, we've Hillary Clinton is chancellor of the Queen's University Belfast, and it's part of her husband's legacy, the Good Friday Agreement. Do you have any insight as to what you've heard back in Washington? Is that, do you think the Clintons will get involved?
It's very hard to tell. Everybody else from prior Democratic administration seems to be getting involved, and they've talked about different roles for Hillary too. But I just think my own experience in transitions is that good intentions are bad. It is completely out of control, and it's very hard to establish priorities. So therefore, the old adage about the squeaky wheel getting the attention is correct. And I don't think the Boris Johnson's government should sit back and wait for the phone call from Biden. I think they need to be proactive, and maybe they are already quietly behind the scenes, and behind the scenes it's fine. But I would be moving politely but aggressively.
Yes, and certainly I'll just give a plug to HJS. We a couple of years ago did some research, wrote a report entitled Global Britain that was backed by a little known backbencher at the time. I wouldn't say little known, but Boris Johnson, who endorsed our report. And it's become this idea of what can Britain's role be post-Brexit in the world, in a foreign policy sense, in a security sense. Britain's active members, obviously, in the Five Eyes. What do you think might be Britain's key opportunity to play from a security perspective in the world?
Yeah, well, you know, I think the hardcore pro-Brexit elements of the Conservative Party have always understood that Britain's role in the European Union has been less than it could have been and should have been in global strategic matters. In fact, that's one of my principal critiques of the European Union is less than the sum of its parts, certainly in the politico-military domain. So I think that as Britain comes out, its immediate role as a key NATO member and one of the five permanent members of the Security Council cries out for some initiative and taking some steps that I think would be very helpful to all of us, rather than seeing foreign policy in this wearing blender of the European Union. Britain can be a voice, I think, that will be more important, much more important than it was before. And I think there is an opportunity coming up. The G7 meeting in 2021 will be hosted by Britain. I think perhaps people have forgotten because they're not necessarily so memorable, but there was no G20 meeting in 2020 because the US was host, and with the coronavirus and Trump didn't like the G7 meetings or the G20 meetings, while we're on the subject anyway. So Boris Johnson has a real opportunity after what will be a two-year hiatus to take some important steps. And I think that would highlight Britain's role as well. So this is a clear moment of opportunity and available for the taking.
Yeah, no, very interesting. It's as far as President-elect Biden, what do you think, how would you advise him on his policy towards Russia and all of this? With Britain leaving the European Union, looking for to develop a way forward. We're just finishing the integrated review here, hopefully come January, to look at Britain's Ministry of Defense and its role in the world. How would you advise a Biden administration on dealing with Russia?
Yeah. Well, just a footnote, if I could quickly, I think Britain's recent announcement about increased defense expenditures is very important and hopefully will be an inspiration to the Biden team. We've been in this curious inversion about Russia for the past 4 years because Trump never wanted to admit that there was any effort by the Russians to interfere in the 2016 election, fearing that that would undercut the legitimacy of his win and give credence to the Russia collusion point. And as I say, we actually did some very tough things with respect to the Russians, but Republicans twisted themselves into pretzels trying to say nice things about Russia, which was a historical reversal. And now we've had 4 years of the Democrats being tough on Russia, which is against their DNA as well. So yeah. I think it's going to be, I think you could see here a reversion to the norm. Biden's very eager to negotiate a successor to the New START agreement. If you look back at 2010, in the Senate vote on New START as negotiated by Obama, Republicans came close to getting enough negative Republican votes to defeat the treaty in the Senate. It takes two-thirds of those present voting. I was against it in 2010, and it's not a treaty that's gotten any better with age. And yet the Russians are very eager to get a five-year extension of the treaty. And if I were a Russian, I'd want to extend it too. So it's, I think it will be a test of Biden to see if he can get beyond the Russia collusion rhetoric of the Democrats for 4 years and really strategically think in political military terms how to protect against a Russia that has we've just had this report coming out about Navalny and the really conclusive evidence of high level Russian involvement in the assassination attempt, which it clearly was. I mean, I don't know how much more evidence we need coming on top of this massive, sophisticated Russian computer attack. I mean, these are not our friends. What else does it take to figure that out?
Yeah, certainly I'm mindful, though, I'll have to open up for some Q&A from the audience here in a minute, but I want to squeeze in Afghanistan, something near and dear to my heart, having served there. How do we solve a problem like Afghanistan? I'm sorry to do a switch on you, but we've been there for almost 20 years and it has a lot of natural resources. China has its eye on the natural resources. It'd be a wonderful addition to the Belt and Road Initiative, a lot of people speculate. How do we solve this problem? Do we withdraw? And if so, what does that achieve? What might be some of the options for President Biden?
Right. Well, I'd say, look, I think the United States did exactly the right thing after 9/11 to get al-Qaeda and to overthrow the Taliban. I think mistakes were made subsequently in getting too involved in a nation building exercise. We were never going to make Afghanistan the Switzerland of Central Asia, just not in the cards. So I think we actually spent more money on projects that probably weren't going to be very helpful than we needed to. And I think we probably overestimated our ability to fuse this very diverse country together. The amount we've spent on the Afghan National Army has not been justified. Now, all that said, it would be a terrible mistake, in my view. It is a terrible mistake to think that we can negotiate a peace deal with the Taliban, especially one that the Trump administration conducted without the active involvement of the Afghan government. I think there has to be a long-term U.S. and NATO presence in Afghanistan for several reasons. Number one, the basic counterterrorism function. But also, you know, if you look to the right and the left of Afghanistan, you've got a nuclear power in Pakistan, you've got a would-be nuclear power in Iran, you've got two states with significant terrorist ties. There's a lot of reason to stay there. Now, a lot of Americans say, well, we want an end to the forever wars and we've been there 20 years, da, da, da. Look, this is a concept people in Britain are well familiar with, forward defense. I'd rather be there for a long period of time. hopefully detecting and minimizing threats to the United States and the West as a whole early rather than later. Yeah. But you need leaders in the United States who explain that to the people who do ask, we've been there 20 years, how long are we going to stay? You know, the answer to that question in Korea and Japan is 75 years plus, ditto Europe. So 20 years looks like a drop in the bucket when you think in those terms. The United States is a global power. It was wrong to think that we can retreat and that withdrawing forces from unpleasant places is going to make us safer. That's not the case. Whether Biden can articulate that, whether he really believes it or not, or whether he and Trump actually see it the same way, I think we're going to see very early. Trump's decisions to reduce U.S. forces in Iraq and Afghanistan before January 20, I think, puts those decisions forward to Biden earlier than he wanted to see them. They will be on his plate on January the 20th, and he's going to need to make up his mind pretty quickly.
Yeah. Oh, thank you for that. Yeah, it's Afghanistan is a dilemma, but like you said, the Chinese certainly take a long-term approach to international relations, and very, very interesting that it needs to be explained in more clear terms to the American people. Certainly you've got, as you alluded to, Iran on the left side of Afghanistan that's been involved in Afghanistan since we've been there since 2001. So it is an interesting dilemma that we've got moving forward. I'm just going to take a question from the audience that is related to this somewhat. This is from Max Strindkopf. He says, I'm very much enjoyed your book and found it educational, as I did. With what has transpired since the USA withdrew from the Iranian nuclear agreement, in hindsight, what would you have done? What would you have done differently, if anything?
Well, I think one of the principal arguments against withdrawing was that unilateral U.S. sanctions could not produce the result that multilateral sanctions had not produced. That is to say, changing Iran's behavior and trying to get deliverable nuclear weapons. In fact, U.S. sanctions had a devastating effect on Iran because of the reach of the U.S. economic influence. People with a choice to do business with Iran or do business with the United States actually made a fairly predictable decision. But I don't think we applied the sanctions as vigorously as we should have. I think the lesson from economic sanctions in a wide variety of contexts is the way they work best is massively applied very quickly and rigorously enforced. And we gave the Iranian regime some outs in the way the sanctions were applied. They weren't as comprehensive as they could have been. And I don't think ultimately President Trump was willing to accept what I think is the only logical conclusion to a policy of maximum pressure, which is that means regime change if you don't see strategic decision by the Ayatollahs to give up the pursuit of nuclear weapons. And I don't think they've made that decision. I think one of the things we'll find out only a long time from now is how much cooperation there is and has been between North Korea and Iran, and not just on the nuclear side, but on the ballistic missile side as well. We know there's been a lot on ballistic missiles going back for 25 years, and I suspect that's true in the nuclear aspect as well. So it would be a mistake if Biden thought he could just revive the deal. I think even the Europeans know the deal was badly flawed. And the expiration of the Security Council sanctions against conventional weapons sales, particularly missiles, was a terrible element of the nuclear deal. And how to get that put back in place is going to be significant. Iran really doesn't have a lot of incentives to come back into the deal. We gave them in 2015 $120 to $150 billion worth of cash, unfrozen assets. There isn't anything left to unfreeze. So that very attractive part of the deal in 2015 for Iran doesn't exist today. I think Biden's going to find it a lot harder to have an Iran policy than he thought.
Great. No, thank you very much for that perspective. That question actually came from one of our donors. So hopefully that will suffice, and I'll give you a cut of whatever he donates to us. So let's take another question. We've got, this one's from Latika Bork from the Sydney Morning Herald in Australia. China, she says, has hit Australia with trade tariffs since it called for an inquiry, leaving the door open for countries, including Australia's allies, to fill the gap in supply. Is Biden better equipped than Trump to unite the alliances? And how should the allies respond to China to stop smaller countries being picked off?
Yeah. Well, look, this is a critical question. Obviously, Australia has key economic relations with China, supplying raw materials for Chinese manufacture. And the way China has treated Australia in that respect and a number of other things they've done has been a clear effort to intimidate them and by brute force get them to back away. It's very similar to what happened to Canada after Canada arrested the Huawei CFO, Meng Wanzhou, the daughter of the founder, at our request. China seized in the middle of the night two Canadian citizens in China on trumped up charges, and they're still held in jail. And it was obviously intended to split Canada from the United States, to split Australia from the United States. I think we ought to see it for what it is. If this is the way China behaves now, how are they going to behave when they become more powerful? This is a sign of things to come. So it does require, I think, the West as a whole getting a more unified position. It's one of the reasons why I think the U.S. needs to resolve its trade disagreements with the European Union. I think we're done now with Canada and Mexico for a while, but with Australia, with Japan, with others, there are always going to be trade disagreements. I think the U.S. has gotten bad trade deals in the past. They need to be corrected. But we all have a common interest dealing with China, and not just on trade, but geostrategically as well. But certainly, China's theft of intellectual property, forced technology transfer have affected all of us negatively and provide a very clear basis of common interest to work together. I think Trump was kind of congenitally unable to do that sort of coalition building. I think Biden is probably better at it, but I would just remind everybody what Donald Rumsfeld used to say, which is that it's the objectives that should define the coalition, and not the coalition which defines the objectives. So I think we need to have some urgent discussion, and I'm sorry more didn't take place during the Trump administration, about defining clear common objectives. And this is not a grand strategy to last for 100 years. We've got to act now quickly. We'll have to do more talking later, but we can't really waste any more time. And again, this is it's an opportunity for Biden, but a big test for his new administration too.
Yes. Yeah. And thank you for giving a shout out to my former boss, Secretary Rumsfeld. Along those lines, China, you think, is still the key to North Korea? And in your book, I really enjoyed the chapters about meeting the Supreme Leader, Kim, and you had some misgivings. So although Trump was a little bit, President Trump was a little bit giddy about the possibilities of making some inroads there, and you saw that really was a false hope. Do you still think that? And what do we do about North Korea, and how do we get China to help, if at all?
Yeah. Well, look, the key in any denuclearization effort is some indication of a strategic decision by the proliferator that they're prepared to give up nuclear weapons. That's what I have always meant by the Libya model of 2003-2004, really, which was led by British intelligence because of its contacts with Gaddafi and his regime. And it worked. Gaddafi saw what had happened to Saddam Hussein in Iraq, said, I'm not willing to take a risk of that. I'm going to give up this nuclear weapons program. And that's what happened. Neither Iran nor North Korea have made that strategic decision. And North Korea is now close enough to having the capability of putting a warhead on an ICBM and hitting targets basically worldwide. Our options are much reduced. This is part of the cost of 4 years of the Trump administration added on to 8 years of the Obama administration, not taking this threat seriously enough. I think we've got to add North Korea to the list of issues that that China is responsible for. I think they've gotten away for a long time by saying, oh, well, we want to help facilitate a deal here too. Look, China could bring North Korea to its knees very quickly. Everybody knows that. I think they're happy to have North Korea develop nuclear weapons. It doesn't threaten China. It does threaten Japan and the United States and others. And I think we've got to hold China responsible for North Korea's behavior. Again, this is part of the test for Biden. I'm not sure that he's prepared to do that.
Interesting. So, let's take another question from the audience here, shifting to another part of the world. This comes from Colin Shakchat. Do you think that the flurry of normalization agreements between Israel or among Israel and certain Gulf states and Morocco will change the narrative with regard to the Israel-Palestinian conflict and enable meaningful negotiations?
Well, I think certainly the UAE, Bahrain recognition of Israel and the peace agreements there, and there was a lot of complex diplomacy involved in it, but they are a reflection of the shifts of the tectonic plates in the region as much as anything else. And that is the Gulf Arab states in particular, recognizing that Iran is a threat to them, not so much because of the nuclear and ballistic missile programs, but because of Iran's hegemonic aspirations, its support for terrorism, and its conventional military forces, which we see playing out now in Yemen, Iraq, Syria, and Lebanon. And that view of the world has brought them to a position very close to Israel's. So it shouldn't be any surprise that with that convergence of interest, you see active steps being taken at a public level to combine more effectively. But a lot of this has been going on just slightly beneath the surface for a long time. So I think there are more recognition decisions coming. Morocco is a little bit of a different story, and I have my own views on that one. I've just got an article up on the foreign policy website because of my concern for the Sahrawi people of the Western Sahara. But leaving that aside, Sudan has also recognized Israel. Bhutan has recognized Israel, not an Islamic country, but another country from the quote unquote third world. I think people are waking up to reality. For the Palestinians, I have to say, recalling Abi Ibn's famous comment about the PLO, the Israeli foreign minister once said, the PLO never misses an opportunity to miss an opportunity. And the Palestinian Authority has just missed the earth go by here as the Gulf Arab states in particular join Jordan and Egypt in recognizing Israel. I think the two-state solution is not workable anymore. There aren't a lot of good ideas. My idea is what I call the three-state solution: give the Gaza Strip to Egypt, Jordan and Israel should divide up the West Bank, and Jordan should resume sovereignty, even if somewhat limited, over the portions that Israel doesn't annex. A lot of people don't like that. Fine, I'm open to other solutions, but if you think the two-state solution is going anywhere, I think that's not going to happen.
That's very interesting. We've got an associate fellow, Dr. Simon Waldman. We're just coming out with a paper here, actually within a couple weeks, on the fallacy of the one-state solution. I'll have to send you a copy and get your comments on that.
Okay.
Thank you for that. So we've got a short question here from Tim Wallacey Wilsley. And he asks, what should Biden's approach be with Pakistan?
Well, this has been a problem. It's been linked in American foreign policy with India and Afghanistan for a long time, and we've shifted back and forth. And it's been very hard and difficult for administrations of all kinds to come up with the right answer. I mean, Pakistan itself is responsible for much of the terrorist activity of Taliban and the Haqqani networks and others in Afghanistan, as it is for terrorist activity in Kashmir and elsewhere in India. And it's terrorism that threatens the stability of the Pakistani state itself. And I think they recognize it, but they're not sure what to do about it. To me, though, the most important strategic reality is Pakistan is a nuclear weapons state, and one where there's enormous Chinese influence, and where there's a risk of a nuclear confrontation with India almost at any moment. We saw that, in fact, in 2019, where a terrorist attack and an Indian response put us very close to open hostilities. I think there has got to be more focus on the risk of the Pakistani state itself falling under the control of terrorists, whether it's Pakistani, Taliban, or others, and that entire nuclear arsenal coming under terrorist control. That would be Iran on steroids immediately. It's easier said than done, though. I don't underestimate at all the difficulty of doing it. America's interests are conflicting. We want good relations with Pakistan to help us in Afghanistan. We don't want a confrontation with India, but the Pakistan military basically itself has created the problem through its Inner Services Intelligence Directorate, and it's got to figure out a way to solve it.
Mm-hmm. I'll take another question here. We're getting close to the end here. This one comes from Vernon Bogdanor, and he asks, democracies sometimes seem on the defensive in relation to Russia, China, North Korea, Iran. Do they need stronger machinery to coordinate a common approach to the problems they face?
Well, look, I think there's definitely some thinking warranted about what the best way to handle challenges to Western values that we see for the rest of the century. And they come in a variety of different sizes and shapes. But as I said earlier, I think China is number one, two, and three on the list. And people talk about leagues of democracies and things like that. And this is something that's been discussed for a long time without much progress. What I would propose as a serious step forward, it's not my idea, it's Jose Maria Aznar's idea, former Prime Minister of Spain, wrote a little essay about this about 15 years ago for NATO to essentially expand its membership worldwide, to bring in Japan, Australia, Singapore, Israel, a couple of suggestions. And if you consider NATO with the current exception of Turkey, or at least quasi-exception, if you consider NATO to be what it is today, which is a league of democracies, going global would get you to that point. Now, this brings us head on to the discussion with the European Union about whether they think they should have a bigger military dimension to the EU than they do. I've always thought that was a mistake. I think it's an EU military capability is a dagger pointed at NATO's heart. But rather than think of something entirely new, you've got NATO. It will be a stronger alliance. I think as countries have heeded what Trump said and looked at their commitment in Wales in 2014 to spend 2% of GDP on defense, it's moving in the right direction. And Jose Maria Aznar's suggestion is one I think we ought to consider.
Very interesting. So along those lines, with a sort of NATO 2.0, expanded NATO, a question came in, but I want to frame it this way. So Bernard Herman asks, should the United States guarantee the security of Taiwan in the event of a conflict with China? I'd probably also add to that, should a NATO 2.0 guarantee the security of Taiwan? What do you think about that?
Well, I think we're almost there already, given the Taiwan Relations Act of 1979. And I've said now for over 20 years that I think the United States should extend full diplomatic relations to Taiwan. Now, in the past, China has said, well, countries that do that, we're going to cut off relations with them. Well, it's one thing to do that with Guatemala or Fiji or something like that. It's quite something else when the U.S. says it. And I think from, I would say this to the Biden administration, this is an asymmetric way of responding to offensive Chinese behavior. If they do something that we don't like, we don't necessarily have to meet them on that ground. We can respond asymmetrically too. And, you know, it's very important to establish a credible deterrent. I think in the Clinton years, for example, people wondered whether he would stand up if China threatened Taiwan. And you'll recall that he did. He sent two carrier battle groups heading toward Taiwan, end of controversy. I used to ask during the Obama administration when I was in speaking engagements, do you think Barack Obama would do the same thing? And in dozens of such events around the United States and elsewhere, nobody ever raised their hand. So if we could figure that out, the Chinese could too. So I think, and Trump's disdain for Taiwan was unfortunately well known. So I think this is a critical moment. I think if China senses weakness, I think Taiwan's vulnerable. Not that they want military hostilities. They want Taiwan to fall into their hands like a ripe fruit. But we're at a dangerous point now, I think.
Yeah, and along those lines, do you think that China should be held accountable for the coronavirus? This comes in from Mark Newman. Said, should China actually pay global compensation towards the vaccine costs and repair the damage caused? That might be a solution. What do you?
No, look, I think there are a lot of ideas like that we can put out on the table, and and China was responsible, and nobody should forget it.
Yeah. Well, I think we are coming to an end here. I know I'm cognizant you've got another engagement. So I just wanted to allow you any opportunity to, if you had to ask yourself a question that we haven't asked you, what would that be and what would your response be? What else might you want to talk about?
Well, we've certainly talked about Iran and North Korea, but I do think that the proliferation of weapons of mass destruction and the continuing threat of terrorism worldwide are things that, as we deal with the strategic threats of China and Russia, we shouldn't lose sight of. Although the nuclear side of proliferation gets the most attention, I think people will recall that biological and chemical weapons are often called the poor man's nuclear weapon. You don't need the investment or infrastructure for them that you do for nuclear weapons. And if the coronavirus pandemic worldwide has shown anything, it's just how vulnerable complex societies are to what could be biological warfare. The spread of the pandemic has a lot in common epidemiologically with the use of biological weapons. Or weapons against food supplies. That's another possibility. Mm-hmm. So I think we ought to be much more focused on this. And it's one reason that I worry not just about terrorist groups and rogue states, but countries like Russia and China that have made chemical and biological weapons important elements in their own calculation. I think the 21st century is going to be a dangerous place, not because this is an ideological conflict. I think China, this is not Cold War II, because I don't think it's ideological in that sense, but I do think it's a clash of systems. I think you can see China's behavior in Hong Kong, where it's effectively ending its commitment to the UK to have a one country, two systems policy. That's disappearing. You can see its repression of the Uyghurs in Xinjiang province. You can see it in the field of social metrics, where China judges the worth of its own citizens. It's not a society we want to live in. And I think we need to wake up to that civilizationally and find an effective strategy to deal with it.
Yes. And certainly along those lines, I guess the last question I wanted to ask you is, if you, well, what's next for you? Has Has President-elect Biden contacted you? What's next for you?
Well, the answer to the question about the president-elect is no, and I don't spend a lot of time sitting by the phone waiting for it. We'll see what happens. But I think in the post-Trump era, the Republican Party needs a conversation about, frankly, how to get back to a Reaganite party, optimistic, looking to the future, oriented to its basic principles of limited government at home and peace through strength overseas. The party should not be about personalities. It should be about policy. So I'll be spending a fair amount of time on that, as well, obviously, as commenting on the mistakes the Biden administration makes and hopefully offering congratulations when they get it right.
Yeah, that's it. And hooray for democracies, because you can do that in the democratic world. Well, exactly. I want to thank you very much, Ambassador Bolton, for your time. It's been a real honor and a pleasure to talk with you today. And I hope you'll come back for another round, hopefully when the pandemic calms down a little bit, you can come over to London and we can host you again.
Well, thanks again for having me today, and thanks to everybody for tuning in. And I look forward to seeing you in London in person in 2021.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.